This is a battery, but so is this.
When you think of batteries, you probably think of 9 volts or D cells or car batteries. But as we move towards producing and storing more renewable energy, like solar and wind energy, we have to start thinking bigger, like much bigger. Let's start off with some battery basics. A battery is simply something that stores energy. The ones that we're most familiar with, like in our phones and our remote controls, are chemical batteries. These batteries store energy in the form of chemical energy and turn it into electricity. Now, while you may think of batteries as a relatively new concept, you might be surprised to find out that they were invented all the way back in 1800 by an Italian physicist named Alessandro Giuseppe Antonio Anastasio Volta. Oh, say that 3 times fast. At the most basic level, electricity is just the flow of electric charge. Charge is a property of matter, and remember that matter is everything. Books and dogs and tacos and the device you're watching this on, they're all made up of matter. And all matter can have a charge, either positive or negative. Electrons, the negatively charged particles that reside around an atom's nucleus, can move charge from one place to another. Often when we're talking about electricity, we're talking about a flow of electrons from one place to another. So you can break a chemical battery down into a few very basic parts: a negative electrode, a positive electrode, and an electrolyte. The positive and negative electrodes are the two terminals of the battery. The electrolyte is a chemical that allows ions to move between the electrodes, but prevents the flow of electrons. So let's look at a typical alkaline AA battery. Here in this alkaline battery, our negative electrode is made up of zinc, and the positive electrode is made of manganese dioxide. A potassium hydroxide paste acts as our electrolyte. The zinc electrode releases electrons. The manganese dioxide at the other terminal wants electrons. And the electrons want to get from one terminal to the other, but they can't move through the electrolyte. Instead, you have to place a wire between the two terminals, which will allow the electrons to flow from the negative electrode to the positive electrode and create a circuit, powering whatever is in its path. During this discharge, we call the electrode that electrons are leaving the anode, and the electrode that is receiving the electrons the cathode. Over time, the materials in the two terminals are converted into new materials, all of the stored chemical energy is converted to electrical energy, and then the battery dies. You know that old saying, when life gives you lemons? Well, we're not making lemonade. We're making electricity. Remember, all you need is an anode, a cathode, and an electrolyte. For the anode, we have this zinc galvanized nail. For our cathode, we'll use this copper penny, and the lemon is our electrolyte. Plug them in with some wire in between, and you can see that this LED bulb lights up. So what's happening here? The zinc nail is oxidized, producing electrons. These electrons flow through the wire to the copper of the penny. Here, the electrons are picked up by positively charged hydrogen ions, protons, which come together to form hydrogen gas. The chemical batteries we use every day rely on metals like zinc, lead, nickel, and lithium in their electrodes. And the different internal chemistries can make some batteries more suited to one type of job than another. For example, alkaline batteries, like this AA battery here, have a slow discharge rate, meaning they can hold onto their charge for a long time just sitting on a shelf at your grocery store. But most of the time, they can only be used once. Their chemical reactions, which rely on zinc and manganese, are usually not reversible, and the materials in their electrodes can't be reformed. So once they're dead, these batteries are just e-waste. But we can enable the use of mobile devices and reduce the amount of waste we create by using rechargeable batteries. Some of the earliest rechargeable batteries ever developed were car batteries. They're big, but rechargeable, making them perfect for starting cars over and over and over again. Your car has an alternator, which is basically just a generator connected to your engine. The alternator uses the energy from your running engine to strip electrons from the positive terminal and send them back to the negative terminal. This reverses the chemical reactions and recharges the battery. But lead-acid batteries are pretty big and bulky for the amount of energy that they hold, and they don't recover too well after many cycles of being fully discharged and then recharged. So if you leave your headlights on one too many times, you're gonna need a whole new battery. And you're likely familiar with other batteries that can be recharged just by plugging them into an outlet, like nickel metal hydride batteries. These can use an alkaline electrolyte, like potassium hydroxide, But the reactions at both electrodes are reversible. However, these batteries lose their charge pretty quickly, especially at warmer temperatures. In fact, they lose about 20% of their charge in the first 24 hours after recharging. They also store less energy by weight than something like a lithium battery. And speaking of lithium batteries, you know, the types of batteries that power our phones and laptops, they're light and compact, perfect for these objects that we carry around with us. And while they sound really fancy, they work just like any other chemical batteries. They most often have a lithium-containing electrode and a graphite electrode. Lithium atoms are really small. It's only the third element on the periodic table, meaning it only has three protons in its nucleus. But this tiny atom has a high electrochemical potential, meaning it releases a lot of energy when it donates an electron, and so it can store a lot of energy relative to its mass. This makes it great for storing a lot of energy in a small space. But lithium batteries are expensive and can have some safety trade-offs. They can catch fire if pierced and exposed to the air. That's really not great. So with all these new smartphones and electric cars, which commonly use lithium-ion batteries too, the lithium powering these devices has to come from somewhere. And a lot of it comes from places like Argentina, Chile, Tibet, Australia, Bolivia, and the list goes on. These lithium mines use huge quantities of water and power to extract the mineral from the earth. So while lithium can help us store renewable energy, it has some environmental costs of its own. And if you want to learn more, check out our video on lithium-ion batteries, which you can watch up here or down here. But batteries are important to the future of producing sustainable energy. Currently, the world's largest lithium battery is in Australia, and it was unsurprisingly built by Tesla. No, not Nikola Tesla, but the car company Tesla. It's part of the Hornsdale Power Reserve site in South Australia. This battery has a storage capacity of 129 megawatt hours. That's equal to around 33 million AA batteries, though a new expansion of 64.5 megawatt hours is trying to push that number even higher. At its peak output, it can power about 30,000 homes. This site stores renewable energy and keeps the power grid stable when there's a surge of electrical usage. This giant battery is right next to a wind farm. Solar and wind energy are unpredictable. That means if the wind farm produces lots of energy during high demand times, like a hot summer day when everyone is using their air conditioner, much of the energy can be used by the grid immediately. But if the energy is produced during a low demand time, for instance, like in the middle of the night when everyone's asleep, the energy is stored in the battery until the next time it's needed. But even the most gigantic lithium-ion batteries aren't going to solve all of our renewable energy storage needs. First off, they're really expensive. And the size of batteries we would need to hold excess renewable energy might just be a problem too. Energy demands and production fluctuate throughout the year as the weather changes. Currently, large amounts of petroleum and coal are used in the summer as we run air conditioning in our homes and offices, while in the winter months, we turn natural gas into heat. It's estimated that just California alone would need to store 36.3 million megawatt hours of energy generated during the summer months, when wind and solar generation are high, to get 100% of the state's energy from renewable sources throughout the year. Assuming it was a battery like the one at the Hornsdale site, that amount of storage would take a lithium-ion battery around 7 feet tall and over 695,000 acres, which is bigger than Jacksonville, Florida. That is simply too big. But here's where things get really interesting. Chemical batteries aren't the only way to store energy. In fact, some of the biggest batteries in the world are actually lakes. About an hour outside of Los Angeles is Pyramid Lake. This lake stores energy, enough energy to power up to 83,000 homes in a day.
But it doesn't work like the chemical batteries we've talked about so far. Instead, it stores energy as gravitational potential energy.
So here's how it works. Pyramid Lake is part of what's called a pumped storage hydropower plant. These kinds of plants store energy by moving water between two reservoirs at different heights.
When energy demand is low, or there's a lot of unused power being generated by renewable sources, that excess energy is used to pump the lake water up into the higher reservoir. Here, hundreds of thousands of gallons of water are pumped 7.5 miles uphill from the lake below through six gigantic pipes, 30 feet in diameter. Then, when more energy is needed, a valve is opened and gravity causes the water to flow back downhill through the same pipes, converting the stored or potential energy to kinetic energy. This flow is used to turn massive turbines, which generate electricity, just as they would in a typical hydroelectric plant.
We can figure out just how much potential energy the plant stores as long as we know how much water is pumped to the upper reservoir, the difference in height between the two reservoirs, and the density of water. The maximum capacity of the plant in the upper reservoir is 170,000 acre-feet, or 210 billion liters of water. Because water's density is 1 kilogram per liter, that means the mass of water is 210 billion kilograms. And even though the water travels a total of 7.5 miles, or about 12,000 meters, the elevation change between the two lakes is only 324 meters because it's going up the slope of a hill. So we can calculate the potential energy this water has by multiplying the mass of the water by the acceleration of gravity by the change in height. We get a potential energy of almost 6.7 times 10 to the 14th joules, meaning the lake could theoretically generate 190 million kilowatt hours of energy. Of course, there are some losses due to friction, but pumped storage can have an efficiency of up to 75 to 80%, which is not too shabby.
Now, the facility in Los Angeles is just one of many across the world. The United States currently has 42 facilities that can store around 21,000 megawatts, and the one here at Pyramid Lake can supply electricity to around 83,000 houses in a day.
But not too many places have exactly the right configuration of lakes, and even 21,000 megawatts is just scratching the surface of how much power we actually need. Los Angeles County alone has over 3 million homes that need access to reliable power.
So what are some other big battery options? Well, one involves molten salt. How cool is that?
At some solar power plants, giant mirrors called heliostats focus sunlight on a tower filled with molten salt. Throughout the day, the heliostats actually follow the sun and direct as much light as possible at the tower. The salt inside the tower heats up to a top temperature of 565 degrees Celsius. If power is needed immediately, the hot salt is used to boil water, which creates steam, which moves turbines, thus turning the heat energy back into usable electrical energy. The salt can also be stored in big insulated tanks and used later, like at night when the sun isn't out.
But when I say salt, I'm not actually referring to this stuff. The salts in these towers are often a combination of potassium nitrate and sodium nitrate. Why? Three reasons.
First, they're liquid at the operating temperatures of the plant, which means they can be easily pumped where they need to be. Table salt doesn't melt until it's much hotter. Second, they're stable up to 600 degrees Celsius, which is way more heat than is needed to boil water. And third, they have high thermal convection efficiencies, which is just a fancy way of saying they're really good at absorbing heat from the mirrors and then transferring that heat to the water without losing too much in the process. And there are a lot of other methods being proposed to store energy generated by sustainable sources. Compressed air, heavy weights lifted up mine shafts, and pressurized water are just some of what's being proposed. Imagine using energy to lift a weight high up in a mine shaft, storing that energy as potential energy. Let the weight fall back down, turning a turbine as it goes, and you can recapture that energy when you need it. There's even a Swiss company proposing to store electricity as gravitational energy by building giant towers of 35-ton composite blocks. In reality, it's not that different from what they're doing at Pyramid Lake.
Unconventional? Maybe. But personally, I am okay with giant energy storage Jenga. And without storage solutions, excess renewable energy could ultimately go unused and wasted. So while a number of companies are all proposing these wild and innovative ideas, we don't exactly know what the future for large-scale batteries will look like. And it may not be a single solution, but instead many solutions working together to bring us reliable power. And as renewable energy becomes less and less expensive, we'll need to figure out where to store all of this clean energy very soon.